5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
It's the new Panic Room. It's the show other shows want to be, and the show that authors want to be on.
All-new Panic Room radio show is brought to you by HellboundBooks.com.
Well, well, good evening. It is, I don't even know what it is, to be honest with you. It is probably Thursday, probably 9:30 Central, and it's the new Panic Room, episode 101. So, bit of an anti-climax, to be honest. We had our 100th show last week, and now it's just, here we go again. So, it's just... Oh, dear. So, I need a good old moan, so I'm going to bring my old mate on. It's Xtina. How are you? I was just listening. Obviously, that was Staying Alive by the Bee Gees, which is considering two of them are dead now, is in bad taste, really. They should not play that. They should not make that available anymore because, you know, Barry and Robin, or his fucking name, is dead now. So,
it's still a good song.
The big tall hairy one, he's still alive. He's still going. Morris. Old Morris, he's still all right, I think.
I have no idea. How would I know? No clue.
No, clearly.
No.
Clearly not. Clearly not. So, tell me, it's all very odd. I mean, we had such a manic show last week with everybody sort of ringing in and everyone want a piece. It's just all going on, and here we are, you know, we're now on the... it's exciting. I mean, we're at sort of the countdown to our 2 years, which will be obviously show 104. And then obviously it's, you know, another 2 years of slog and that's that. So I'm looking forward to that. Yeah, it's,
I am too. I am. We had a great show last week. It was awesome. And, you know, I say here's to 100 more. And so I definitely am excited. We always have such a great time. We do. It doesn't matter, no matter what has gone on, you know, the week before, the days before, it doesn't matter. When we get on the show, everything is just awesome. So I had a weird week because of the weird holiday right in the middle of it kind of just messed me up.
Yeah. Hello? I knew it was going to be one of those shows. I really did know it was going to be one of those shows today. We've lost Xtina. There's a good chance we're going to lose the whole thing because we're just experiencing a massive thunderstorm here in Houston at the moment. So it was always going to happen. We've not heard from the president actually. So let's bring him on. Let's bring him on, shall we? Here we go.
Grab him by the pussy.
You know what uranium is, right? It's a thing called nuclear weapons and other things. Like, lots of things are done with uranium, including some bad things.
A little brush up on nuclear physics there. So obviously bad things.
Every time I hear that.
Bad things are done with uranium. Some bad. It's like bullets. Some bad things are done with bullets and whatnot. I mean, what an oaf. I mean, really, what an oaf. But we haven't had him on for a while, and he's always value for money. He's the Trump Meister General. God bless him.
Yeah.
But hey, apart from that, I mean, I don't know, you probably haven't been following the World Cup. And to be fair, it's usually very depressing because England usually get kicked out in the first round, but we're doing really well. We're in the final eight now, which is fantastic. We literally scraped by against Colombia on Tuesday. Playing Sweden on Saturday. I'm going to get up. It's 9 o'clock our time. I'm actually have set my alarm. I'm going to make my reminder. I will be up anyway, but I'm going to sit and God help the kids if they disturb them. I'm going to sit and watch the game for 3 hours.
Wow.
2 hours.
It's baseball season, so there's nothing besides baseball.
Yeah, I know,
baseball,
but I don't care.
I know
I don't
you
care.
Don't.
That's the thing. I really, in fact.
Strike one.
Yeah.
I've two words to say to that. Shite!
What's the other one?
Shite!
You asked for that one. So, it is one of those weeks. I mean, I've had the week from absolute fucking hell, and pardon my fucking French for fucking swearing. I set this to family listening. Kiddies should be all kids need to learn. You've heard my daughter, she swears worse than I do now.
When I was doing the 11 questions with her, and the question was, what's your favorite? I wanted to, like, you know, say something else, but the question is, what's your favorite curse word? And no hesitation, fuck. No hesitation from her.
Yeah, chip off the old block, that one.
My 14-year-old son will say, oh, my gosh, you said the F word. I mean, he's kind of joking, because I'm sure he talks bad when I'm not around. But when I am around, he will not, you know, he says the F word or something. So,
well, you know. Here's the thing. My dad is 92 now, and I'm obviously mature. I am mature, but still devilishly handsome and youthful. But
you are.
I still can't. If I slip up, I'm just mortified. I never. The pinnacle of my dad's swearing was bloody hell, and that was when you heard that there was some serious shit going down. You know.
Wow.
It's funny, out of the house, I was effing about from the age of 7 or 8. You know, I picked it up at school from a friend, my older sister. Never swore at home. It's funny. I mean, you know, but she never gets into trouble for swearing at school or she goes to stay at friends and she's always very polite. I mean, she's got a bit of sass to her, but because she knows what she can get away with at home, you know, what is appropriate. And she knows at home, you know, the gloves are off at home, she'll call me a motherfucker. I mean, technically, on a technicality, is correct. I mean, I can't really pull her up for that. But she will. Yeah. I mean, I suppose she'd be sort of laying on the sofa, I'd go and fart on her head or something. You motherfucker, you know.
So when I picture your household, like Ozzy Osbourne's house, I'm not far off. I'm really not far off.
You know, we're not. A brother's upstairs. In fact, he's just received a 7-day suspension on PlayStation for hate crimes. Seriously, for harassment and hate speech.
Oh my god!
He said there's a couple of kids. Obviously, they play online. A couple of kids will kick off. Will start it, and of course, him and his mates on their team will weigh in, and of course, the pussies on the other side, they always complain. So he got like a warning about a month or so back. Now he's got a 7-day suspension.
Wow.
And I'm saying, I'm being serious, you've got to be careful. He said, I've got another account, fuck him. So, fair enough.
You know, speaking of, I don't know why I thought about this. I was speaking of, you know, hate crimes and all that stuff there. Nikki has been kind of quiet the past couple of days, hasn't he? I mean, I have not seen
anything. He popped up in my, in the spam folder, the Hellbound Books Publishing LLC spam folder. I always check that every now and then, just because sometimes, you know, important stuff will slip in. And there's one, and he's written paragraphs and paragraphs, and then he's listed this whole list of authors. I think it's a list of all people, because Ramsey Campbell's on there, so people, I think he's pissed off, suggesting that we and I should contact all those people. There's a lot. Nikki suggested we pull an anthology together to show him how it's done. We should do that. But you cannot criticize his commitment to his lunacy. I mean, he's full on, you know. It's just I think because we're taking the tack of ignoring him, I think if you don't, you know, I was riled up, but now I'm just like, just ignore him. Nobody takes him seriously, and, you know, you're just not feeding the fire. You're just not feeding. You're not giving him what he wants, and he'll wander off and bully somebody else. That's a sad thing. You know, he won't stop.
Really,
he'll just do the same thing to other people. And I like to think we're tough, you know. But there are people he will really get to. He's under my skin for a little while, and it's you know, you don't want to be doing that, Nick. If you're listening, seriously, do not.
I just wonder where you know, somebody should be taking care of him. Somebody should be watching him, and nobody is. They're just letting him run around. And, you know, I think there is somebody out there that, you know, maybe it's their job to do this, and they're just not, you know, doing it properly.
Well,
I
read somebody had contacted his family, and they I don't think they want anything to do with him. They said, well, look, if he won't take his meds, he won't take his meds. I mean, I guess that's it. He's obviously a disturbed individual, but and I've said it before. It's like, you know, like if you neglect or, you know, ignore a dog, it will turn to bad behavior just to get some attention. You know, kids are the same.
Yeah.
You know, neglected children often they will become bullies and they will do this, they will do that. You know, they'll be destructive, and it's they just want some attention. They don't care about the dog. They don't care even if you're just beating them. They're getting something. You know.
So are you calling Nicholas a dog? Is that? I mean, I wouldn't complain.
No, I'm saying psychologically, he just wants he craves that attention. And if he put that much effort into developing his writing, I mean, his writing is not brilliant. Some of his ideas are really good. Some of his ideas are good. If he worked at his craft instead of harassing people. this is me being serious, you know. He may be a good writer. If he polished his craft and worked at it instead of all this bullshit, he may get somewhere. But he's not. I mean, he's off and he's been harassing people, 10, 20 years? All that energy that could have been directed into becoming a good writer. Because I said the ideas are there. He's obviously got an incredibly fertile imagination. He says, speaking to some of the things he's called us.
Yeah, they're definitely creative. I mean, I don't think I've ever been called. I'm like, wow, that's impressive, because I didn't know these things about
some of them. Some of them I've written down. I'm going to use those. They're brilliant. Although he called me Japanese the other week, and I'm not really sure. I'm not sure how or where he's. I know. Yeah, it's probably as wide a mark as you're going to get. But in the grand spirit of the whole week being a complete upside down week, we have no Becky tonight because she's not well. We have the overriding threat of the thunderstorm cutting the power out. Our guest we were going to have on sadly had to back out. But we have a fantastic, oh, can you hear that? If I play a rumbling, it's the thunder. Fantastic horror for film critic, teacher and screenwriter, Gemma Files. Which would be great, because if you could be her sister, then you'd be X-Files, and that would be brilliant. do you know, I've been working on that all day. All day, that's it. I deserve a cheer for that. So
that was great.
So, yeah,
Gemma in X-Files. I like that. I do. Yeah.
Brilliant. Brilliant. So I think I'm getting bored with you now. So I think we should. Let's bring Gemma.
Hello.
Hi, is that Gemma? How are you?
Gemma. Yeah. And
hello.
I'm good. Thank you.
So we were just having a good old moan. We're having a good old moan. Is there anything you want to... You can join in. Have a good old moan. What have you got to moan about this week?
Well, pretty much the same thing with the weather. It knocks me out because it does something to my sinuses. So,
oh, no.
Yeah, not too far back, I was completely asleep. Thank you. Thankfully, my husband woke me up.
Whereabouts are you? Where in the country are you phoning from?
She's in downtown Toronto.
Yeah, she's in Canada. Go Blue Jays!
Oh, go Lord! Oh, look, I have ultimate power here. Remember that.
I know.
Well, you know, it's kind of six of one, half dozen of the other, because I was born in Britain.
Ah.
Yeah, I was born in London.
Yay! Oh. So
when did you leave
England?
My parents brought me back to Canada around the time that I was about 2.5.
Oh, wow, yeah.
I became a Canadian citizen when I was 3, so.
Wow.
Oh, well, so have you been back to England since, or you've had enough of that now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a couple of times, yeah.
Oh, I mean, fantastic.
It's a wonderful place, but not, you know, I'm about as Canadian as a sack of wet maple leaves, so.
Yeah, it's funny. I mean, I obviously from the north of England, and I've done the tourist thing around London. We used to go to London a lot on business, and it's great for, you know, a few days, couple of days, 3 days, whatever. But I don't know how people live there. I mean, it's just so full on. You know, it's just the pace. Maybe it's because I'm used to, you know, the Yorkshire way of life. We sort of, you know, take things a little easier up there. But, I would just, a few days in London, it just leaves you exhausted.
Yeah, I mean, it's a lot more like New York. And Toronto is, I'd say, a little more like San Francisco or someplace like that. Melbourne, too, as well.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, hey, Gemma, yeah, thank you for joining us, and thank you for stepping in at the last moment. As I say, it's been, it's funny enough, actually, again, one of my other moments is it's been a common thread through the show, my beef with AT&T. We've just switched over to Comcast, and I have to say, America, everybody listening, Comcast are as much of a shower of shit as AT&T are, but cheaper.
I agree.
It is,
yeah,
the same. It's the same. They got me to sign up. I was in a moment. I've been wanting to move from AT&T anyway, and I've heard that Comcast are better technologically. It's better, but their customers. So they lied to me to get me to sign up to start. I said, I need this. I need that. Yep. The jolly little man came. Oh, we can't do that. And well, what the fuck?
Oh, that's
but
horrible.
Everything. I mean, it's taken them 3 days. To install 3 days to install cable, and then four. Another man's got to come to bury the cable. I thought for real 4 days to install a TV. Seriously, it is by the grace of Comcast that we're actually on the air tonight. Otherwise, had it been Wednesday night, we probably wouldn't have been on. But yeah, okay. So, Jenny's here to talk to us about her book. From Tales from the Lake 5, a story, Always After 3. Is that by any chance, is that a reference to 3 a.m., which is the most common, the most popular time for people to die, apparently?
Wow, that is absolutely true.
It is. It's to do, yeah.
Yikes.
Something to do with how the body's rhythms just kind of
around then. It is the closest we get to death. About around 3 o'clock in the morning, and they say that's when most people decide to shuffle off the mortal coil. So what I would do is sort of set my alarm for sort of 2:30 in the morning, and stay awake for an hour, and just skip it and miss it.
No, I'm
well,
spooked.
I am.
I'm like not going to bed until after.
Problems. So I often don't go to bed until 4 anyways. So.
I'm with you. Yeah, that's what I'm going to do.
So you will live forever then.
Exactly.
What a great strategy. What a great strategy.
completely fucked up otherwise, but, you know, living forever.
Yay.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm with you.
There's a lot of debate about that. You know, would you want to live forever? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I would.
Yeah.
Two choices: live forever or die. Forever.
So, well, you know, you'll see all your loved ones die. Well, you're living forever. You can get more loved ones.
Yes.
That's the hope.
To be honest.
There's a lot. You know, that's great. Yeah.
You know, you marry your childhood sweetheart. I mean, she's going to get old and wrinkly and whatever and all that, and die, and just get another one. You know, I don't know why people have the problem. Yeah, I would so live forever, definitely, without a shadow of a doubt. Not going to happen, yeah. But.
I'm with you. I like the tagline of the book, I do, or the story, you know, you never really know who your neighbors are. You know, that's definitely creepy. I remember reading this, I don't know why I thought about that, because that actually has nothing to do with this, but maybe it does. No, I don't know. I remember this one short story that I read a long time ago, and it was something like the time between, and like when the people would go to work, like, you know, people would go to work, these other people would like come into their house, and like that's where they lived when the other people were at work, and then they like swapped, and it was like they didn't even know the other existed. And I just remember thinking how creepy that was, and I would look around my own house and, you know, be like, that's out of place. Oh my god, it's because the in-between people were here.
Oh, wow, that is awesome.
Yeah,
I tell you, around eating all your snacks.
Yes, that's what.
Yeah, but
you
surely you would notice stuff missing, you know.
Yeah, but
you
then you blame it on your kids.
From the pantry.
You know?
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah. Fair enough. Oh, here's speaking of creepy things, I just jumped in. And I just read this. Somebody had come up with a fan fiction theory about Toy Story. I don't know if you heard this. And it says, somebody, this guy wrote it. He said it was his little girl who said, he's obviously watching the movies. And she said, well, Daddy, said if any of the characters died, Andy wouldn't know. And he'd be playing with their corpses. And I thought that child has got one. She needs, hopefully she'll become a horror writer. She will clean up. What a brilliant imagination.
Dog.
You just, I mean,
yeah.
And that would be, you could do a Toy Story, and Andy's just he's playing with the toys, and they're just dead and flopping around and rotting, and that would be, what a brilliant alternate Toy Story. Toy Story 4, that would be. That would be great.
Creepy, very creepy, but you know, I would watch it, I would read it, whatever, but it'd be totally creepy. Yeah.
Oh,
classic,
definitely, yeah.
Necromancer.
Yeah, love it. So, Gemma, I want to hear more about this.
Okay. Well, I was asked to read an excerpt. Would you like me to do that?
Definitely, definitely. It's my favorite part of the night because I get to drink more. So go ahead.
Cool. Okay, so Always After Three by Gemma Files, an excerpt. The last time you lived alone was in another condominium, five blocks from where you and Kyle live now. One room and a kitchenette, bathroom attached. You slept in pretty much the same place you ate, if not exactly the same place you performed every other bodily function. 10 years in the same apartment, and you barely ever remember passing your neighbors in the halls, let alone knowing any of their names. As far as you were concerned, they might as well have not existed. That's how it always is, you eventually came to realize, here in the city's heart. You know nothing, and you're basically happy to, as if you think your own shell of semi-willful ignorance protects you from having to worry about the bugs in the walls, as opposed to the ones which occasionally crawl out of the drain. The man who might be slowly losing his mind behind that door across the way, as opposed to the very obviously crazy guy who capers each morning at the corner of your street. Not to mention whether or not that cheerfully drunk lady in the unit to your right, who you see fumble with her keys every evening, will doze off one night with a lit cigarette in her hand and burn the whole fucking building down. Best not to buy trouble, like old Aunt Lila used to say, the one you were named after. Don't look too close. Don't question. You might not like the answer. There's always a story if you stop to listen. Always a thread winding around things if you stoop down to look more closely, trailing off into the distance, ready for you to follow. Always a hand just waiting to take yours whenever you reach out in darkness, to grab on fast and hold on tight, never letting go, to yank you headlong out of your comfort zone and strand you somewhere else entirely, forever. Same way here, too, of course. You walk by quickly with your eyes politely averted, even as you check the corners for potential trouble, gaze carefully kept ever so slightly out of focus, see nothing, know nothing, business as usual, until one day, it isn't. The night it starts, you find yourself snapping awake all of a sudden, nose wrinkling, thinking, what the hell is that? Beside you, Kyle's asleep and snoring. The clock on the bedside table says 3.04 a.m., then 3.05. The smell seems to come out of nowhere, pungent and penetrating, an invisible stranger's hot breath right in your face. You can't immediately place why it's so disgusting, and yet. Rotten mushrooms, you think, as you lever yourself up and bumble around in the street lamp lit half-dark, trying to figure out where it's coming from. Asparagus piss. Drunk psycho sweat. Dead skunk. Weed would be pleasant by comparison. Granted, the apartment reeks in general these days, just like the rest of the building. Maybe half a year ago, the condo board voted to renovate. This just happens to be the month they finally decided to strip and replace the old wallpaper, switch out the hall carpets, repaint all the trim and every unit door. The stench of glue and paint so constant, you barely even notice it anymore, which means this new smell must really be something. So I search and I search, and eventually I narrow it down, you tell Kyle in the morning. Know where the worst of it was? The baby's room. He frowns. In it or coming through the wall? The wall. That's unit 770, right? You nod. Okay, well, what do you want me to do about it? Talk to the concierge? You sigh. Maybe not. I mean, it's gone now. Of fucking course. I'm so sorry, hon. Not your fault. He shoots you that same look he's been giving you almost every morning since you finally watched your usual weekly pregnancy test turn blue. The one that says, you look like hell, Lila. How much sleep did you even get, exactly? Maybe that's all you really need. Because while other people spend their first trimester battling morning sickness, what you've ended up with is more like morning, afternoon, and evening sickness, cut with a lovely side order of insomnia, nauseated exhaustion during the day, and a grinding inability to do much more but doze fitfully at night. You're not really showing yet, but your anxiety is up because you had to go off your meds the minute you made the decision to stay pregnant. And since Dr. Spring confirms there's no other real option but to stick it out, that's what you're doing. Suck it up. Smile. Keep yourself occupied. Imitate a good attitude, if nothing else. Maybe this isn't the greatest ever time to have a kid, either, given the state of the world, that avalanche of bad news you're trying your best to block out, and mainly succeeding, especially since you deleted your Facebook app. But then again, when would it be? Babies make their own luck. Your mother-in-law likes to say comfortably, guess we'll see. You all too often find yourself thinking in return, trying to keep your breathing steady. Shit like this truly doesn't help, though. For Christ's sake, you can't even drink coffee anymore. Kyle's checking his phone now, swallowing the last of his oatmeal. You're holding him up and you know it. Aw, man, gotta go. You sure it wasn't just the chemicals they're using outside to strip the floors, the ones that melt the glue from the old carpet? I kind of think I know what carpet glue smells like, Kyle, at this point. All right, sure. So we'll wait, see if it happens again, all right? And then we'll figure something out, okay? Nothing to do but nod, attempting some bad version of a smile. Yeah, thanks for listening. Have a great day at work. Love you. You too. So you pull the blackout shades and fall back into bed, trying to block out the dueling noise of construction from the street and renovation from the hall, while this oh-so-elaborate process going on inside your body sucks you down yet again. Mind blanking by degrees, a wiped Etch-a-Sketch screen. Then it's evening and Kyle's home, enabling you gently through your routine. Dinner, bath, prenatal vitamins, TV, an hour or so of lying in bed with the lights down, hugging. He drifts off to sleep. You don't. Eventually, it's just after 3 in the morning again, and there it is, right on time. That smell, just as strong, just as bad, worse. How's that?
Hello?
Oh, no, you can't stop there. You have to keep going.
Oh, no. I was totally into that. I thought you were just pausing for breath. For the next bit, that was fantastic. I have to say, beautifully read, beautifully. If you ever fancy a career as a narrator for audiobooks, do give us a call. We are looking. Okay. We are looking for them at the moment. We are looking for. We're looking to get a bunch of our books onto audiobooks. So is that something you've contemplated or something you've done for yours?
I actually haven't. Three of my books have been adapted for audiobook, but it's always been somebody else reading them. I would like to read my own stuff. My contract is actors, so reasonably familiar with how to pace myself.
No, brilliant. You should get yourself in a studio and do them yourself. That'd be brilliant.
Yeah, I mean, James has never said that to me, and I think I, you know, have a decent voice here. But for reading, I'm awful. I just start, I get nervous, and then I start to go really fast, and then I stumble, and then it's even worse, and, you know, it's just bad. So we have had occasions where the guest was like, you know, I don't want to read my own stuff. You do it, and then I start to switch. That's not good.
No, to be fair, I mean, I think everybody's the same. Unless it's like with Gemma, you know, you're trained, or you know, you got that experience. You know, you do. I mean, I know Xtina. I do. I know I when I'm reading, because you obviously subconsciously you want to get through it and get it done. I think obviously fear of public speaking, I think, is one of the biggest fears that people
it's
have.
A huge thing.
I think it overshadows spiders and snakes and everything. You know, fear of public speaking, which is ridiculous when you think, what is
me,
the worst that can happen? Yeah. Yeah. Oh, we have both in this house. We have snakes and spiders. So.
Oh, cool.
Well, the snakes are cool. The snakes can stay, but the whole spider thing, which reminds me, I have not gotten an updated picture on the spiders, and I'm kind of wondering what the little guys look like, you know, if they've gotten any bigger and stuff. And
well, the problem is they only come out at night mostly.
Uh-huh.
And obviously it's dark, you know, as soon as you put the light on, they scuttle off back into their little corner. But I will make an effort to... So, yeah, they've got bigger.
So
they've shed the skin a couple of times.
Catch.
Oh, no, but they... No. Yeah, I mean, they're in a proper little cage and everything with little plants. And they're happy little guys, actually. They're great.
Oh, yeah, perfect.
They're great, yeah.
Happy little guys.
As long as you give them crickets, I'm sure they're very happy little guys.
That's it. I just chuck... I mean, because we have lizards and whatnot, we've always got... tons of crickets kicking around, so we chuck a few in every few days, and then, yeah, I mean, crickets are not so happy, but probably spoils their day, but bless them.
No,
we try to make them as comfortable as possible.
Yeah, let's make these creepy spiders as comfortable. Do they have names? I don't recall you ever saying anything about names, but.
You will. Well, we're going to have India on after the break. They're hers. You'll have to ask my daughter because she's named them some heart and fluffy bunny or something ridiculous. You have to ask her. She's just seriously.
Wow. Well, they do have like a huge bear of a dog that's name is Fifi, and I think that's adorable. I seriously do. Yeah, I mean,
well, you know, for as vicious and nasty as it's meant to be, because it's thundering a bit, he's in here with me. He's laying at my feet, and he's fast asleep now. But he's just all he came in all trembling, and I don't like it. You know, he's fast asleep, bless him, at the moment. But yeah, they don't like it.
Yeah. That's I don't even.
So Gemma, what you said you had a snake? What snake did you have?
I had a rosy boa. His name was Orm. He lived for I'd say 3 years. Yeah.
Yeah. And then, I love the boas.
Yeah.
Then,
yeah. Absolutely.
I had a ball python.
You know, Toronto's not a great place for snakes, unfortunately. eventually developed some kind of you know, lung disorder, and one day we looked in, and his tallywhacker had flopped out of his cloaca, and we knew that the end was near.
Oh, bless! Oh, poor little guy.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I've had my ball python since 99, so I will have had him 20 years next year.
Oh my God.
We call him Monty, obviously. We've been together a lot of years, actually. So we've got a Burmese as well, and we've had him 13, 14 years now. And he was like an 18-inch sort of little yellow worm when we got him, but he's sort of a bit bigger now. Just a bit.
I don't
bigger.
Even need to go to the zoo. I just want to come to your house and walk around.
Well, we keep saying we should charge the neighborhood kids $1 to come and look at the Longmore Zoo.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Yep. Load them up.
That would be awesome.
Yeah. Give them a snake massage.
Well, we just had to buy and build a bigger cage for my boy's iguana. I mean, this thing's like 6 inches long when we got it, and it's I think with tail, it must be about 4 foot long now. Just you don't realize how big they're going to get. I mean, it's just like huge. Huge, bloody great big. I mean, he's great, but he's just suddenly got big, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, bless.
Well, it is just about time for us to take a short break here. We're going to have a song and come back with, I think we're having Indie Corner tonight. So you hang on, Gemma, and we will be back in a little bit, okay?
All right, no problem.
We will be, yeah, I guess I need to press a button now, don't I?
Yeah, you do, yeah.
Yeah, should I will. We'll be back in about, anyway, 4 minutes 39 seconds, according to this.
Radio Show is sponsored by Hellbound Books, purveyors of all manner of dark fiction. You can find the publisher along with links to all their available works across platforms at hellboundbookspublishing.com. Hellbound Books is proud to be the first in the indie publishing business with their very own app on both Google Play and the App Store. In the mood for something steamy to read, check out new erotica author Jennifer Lynn's website at jenniferlynnerotica.com. You can find James at his website, www.jameslongmore.com, and Xtina has an author page found on the Hellbound website. Don't forget to follow the Panic Room Radio Show on social media. Our Facebook page, unofficial The Panic Room Radio Show, Twitter at Panic Room Radio, our YouTube channel, The New Panic Room Radio Show, and come visit our website at www.panicroomradio.com.
Regime.
welcome back to part two.
You know, this studio audience is so excitable. So we're back. I played that. You know, I should have played it last week, but I didn't. on the very, 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 very first time I did this show, when I came on as a guest all those years ago, the guy who sort of ran it then asked me, what song would you like? And they played that. So that was obviously The Pistols and God Save the Queen. And I saw the Pistols live in Manchester. bless you. Years ago now, before I moved over to America, and they were awesome. They still got it. You know, Johnny and the boys have still just got that attitude. I think he's probably put on a bit now, but because he's got a bit fat and, you know, fat and wealthy. But it was good. So anyway, as promised, sadly we don't have Becky. Get well, Becky. Hopefully she's listening, and if you're listening, you shouldn't be. You should be resting. and we're gonna play her in. We've got Indie Corner coming up. We are gonna play her in, but so here we go. There you go, and it is Indie Corner. Say hi.
Hello,
say
everybody.
Hi to the listener.
Hi, India. Hi. It's been so long. And I, you know, I ask your dad all the time, and you know, so this is the first time we're getting you, and I'm hoping that because it's the summer, you know, we'll get Indie Corner more often.
Yeah.
We're gonna have to have people call in and write in and tell us. Yeah.
we do. People do. They always ask after. They don't. It's not me. Nobody's bothered about me. If I wasn't on, they wouldn't care, but they miss you. So I was just having a chat before we got on air, while the break was going on, and we were pogoing it over here to that. You know, the theme of tonight's show is just having a good old moan.
Yeah.
So do you have something you want to moan about?
I have two things.
Oh, good.
So I was just on my bike, and there is this one car pulling up in a driveway, and it was an empty driveway, and me being the good person I am, stopping on the sidewalk for them to go, and then they stop with half their car out on the road, so I couldn't get past.
Aww.
Boo, we hate those people.
I know.
Yeah.
I hope they're listening. We hate you, people. Yeah.
And
boo.
And then I came in, and so the same day, which was today.
Yeah, it's been a shit of a day, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Isn't it been an absolute shit of a day?
And basically, what happened was there's this car coming around. It's a light car going around our neighborhood.
This is a different car.
Yeah, this is a different car. And so, basically, they were going around, because there's a group of kids, and they honked at that group of kids, and that horn is loud, and it came around, because I was on the other side of the neighborhood, riding my bike, and then I was in nobody's way, and they had the audacity to honk at me, and I wasn't in anybody's way. No, I was in a driveway. I was just riding my bike in nobody's way, and then I fell over, and now my arm hurts because of that. And then
does daddy care?
No,
not really.
And I screamed something a 9-year-old probably shouldn't scream in the neighborhood, but I screamed it.
No, you shouldn't scream fuck you after other people. That's what you shouldn't do.
Wow.
Really. That's not really becoming of a fine young lady, is it?
But still, it's not polite.
They earned it, didn't they?
I almost got up and ran after them.
No, you don't do that. Oh, no, you don't do that, because somebody could take you away, and that would be bad, because we would miss you on the radio show.
I fell over.
Right. Yeah. She's so adorable. I want to keep her. Like, I think that I could just put her in my pocket.
Fine, we'll send her over. You'll soon send her back, believe me.
Well, see, you know, I'm thinking of swap. You know, I send you my 14-year-old kid, and, you know, I get India. I think that would be great.
Yeah, could we not? we have a surly teenager in the house. One is more than enough, thank you.
Yeah, you know what? I remember talking to you. It was like last year when your son was. Our kids are like a year difference. My son's a little younger, and you were like, you know, we don't even see him. He just, you know, he's in his room and he comes out to eat and like that's it. And I don't know believe you or something, or if I didn't believe that that is what was going to happen. But really, I don't see my son. I really don't. He spends most of his time at his sister's, which that is, you know. That's okay, but, you know, he'll come rolling in here like midnight, and then he goes right to bed, and then when he gets up, he leaves again, and it's kind of nice because I'm getting all this quiet time, but, you know, I do remember you specifically telling me about, you know, we don't see him, and I was like, well, you know, I can't wait for that, here it is. So.
I mean, India's as bad now. I mean, she's sort of, now it's summer now, she's sort of, like, almost nocturnal now. She'll stay up till God knows what time, then she sleeps till about noon.
One time, it was about 12, and I was, like, super tired. And so my friend, Malia, as soon as I was dozing off, she called me, and I was like, great, now I'm going to stay up. And like, she was like, well, great, now you can stay up with me, and we can chat to each other. And I thought she was actually joking, but we actually stayed up the whole night. And I could see daylight.
I know. Well, your brother did. I was up, and I heard noises upstairs, like 8 o'clock in the morning. And I was like, what the heck? No, surely he's not up this early. Really. And he was up. He was still up. He was up. And I just popped my head around that. Are you up or are you still? No, I'm still up. I'm going to bed in a bit, he said. And then he went to bed till about 2. So, but there you go. So that was Indy Corner. Is that a good old Mo? So what we're going to, let's bring, are you sticking around?
No.
No, you're bored now?
Yeah.
She's fed up with us all. Say goodbye. Say goodbye to the listener.
Goodbye, peoples at home.
And we'll maybe have you on again next week. We'll do some reading next week.
Goodbye, you know, from the book. India.
Remember, she's no idea what books are. Okay, bye-bye, Indy. We'll see you later. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Thanks for listening to this annoyingness.
Oh, we love you.
Sure.
We love you.
Bye.
Bye-bye, sweetheart. There you go. I tell you, good old... She's got... You know, I mean, how many nine-year-olds do you know use the word audacity? And in context,
you know what,
as well.
I was thinking, I don't even use the word audacity that often, you know? So when I heard it coming out of her, I was like, wow, that's awesome. Yeah. It is. So,
not to mention
really
what she screamed after the lady in the street. So, I told you she's got a mouth on her. But anywho, let's rejoin Gemma. Hello, are you still there?
Hey, yeah.
Hello.
That's a very cute kid you have.
And, oh, thank you. She's
good vocabulary.
She does come by honestly, I have to say. She hears a lot of colourful things from, you know, around, shall we say, but
uh-huh.
Moving on.
If you say so, James. No, it's always great when we have her on the show. We should definitely do it more often now that it's, you know, the summer. But I don't think we get to do these last week? I don't think we did because we were busy with, you know, our 100th show and all the comments and stuff. But I'm excited. I want to do 11 questions with Gemma.
Okay.
And, yeah, she's graciously said that she would do them with us. So.
Yeah, but does she know what she's let herself in for? Gemma,
no,
you will be judged.
Not a clue.
Xtina will judge your answers, so choose carefully.
You know, I didn't think that I did that, but I did listen back to a show, and you can hear it in my response, you know, how I'm judging. Yeah.
Yes, that's a good answer, you say. in that tone. But so, best of luck, Gemma.
And now, 11 questions.
Okay, and this is something that I've not told anybody in quite a long time, and I think that it bears repeating occasionally, but, you know, it's called 11 questions. Now, for a year, mind you, there was a question just missing. Like, there was no, I think it was number 10. It went 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 11, or something like that. And it took me forever to realize that. I mean, you know, I think that's just because I look at them every single week, and they're numbered and everything, and it was just gone. So, you know, I think James did it on purpose to see how long it was.
I did.
And then
it was quite deliberate.
Our next 11 questions actually are like 12. So, you know, I have to say that every so often because I think it's really funny. Anyway, number one, the best or worst movie you ever saw?
A movie that the problem is that I was a film reviewer for about 9 years, so I've seen a shitload of films over the years. It would be difficult for me to even, you know, tell you how many films I've seen. But a film that I always enjoy is John Carpenter's The Thing. I'll watch that movie every time.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I can't judge you too much for that. That's good.
what did you think to the, well, whatever, the recent sequel stroke reboot? What do you think to that?
It wasn't the worst thing I've ever seen, but like most sequels, stroke reboots, stroke sidequels, it was not necessary, per se. There was nothing about it that afterwards I was like, oh, thank God somebody did that, man. You know?
Yeah, it was pretty much more of the same, which was very disappointing, yeah.
It's thundering here. I'm scared. Okay, anyway, number
Excellent.
Two. What was the first grown-up horror novel that you read?
The first one. Probably... you know, it might have been Carrie. My mom got a hold of Carrie, and I stole it from her bedside table the way that I always did. Certainly the first sexy, adult book that I ever read that was horror-oriented, I stole from her, which was Interview with the Vampire. But I would say it would probably be Carrie. Although, for
so
me,
many
brilliant.
The one that I really connected with was actually Night Shift.
Yeah.
Which is not a novel, obviously. It's a,
right.
it's a collection
right.
of short stories. But that
was, yeah, that was
like, bang.
That was the first King that I read was Night Shift. I got Night Shift and then Salem's Lot straight after that, and then The Stand.
Yep.
Which
absolutely,
was,
yeah.
Brilliant, brilliant books, yeah.
Now, there's so many of our guests that I ask that question, and it's always a Stephen King novel, pretty much always. And,
well, you know,
yeah, even mine was
I'm
a
50
Pet
years
Cemetery.
Old. I, you know, like I was, I was born at a particular time, so I think it's a generational thing more than anything else. And also the fact that Stephen King is like the mainstream horror guy. So if you're reading outside of horror and you're likely to encounter horror, it's probably going to be King.
Yep, I agree. What would be the worst way that you can imagine yourself dying?
Anyway?
You can be creative, we've had some really creative answers.
All right. Actually that was going to be my answer anyway, because, you know, any way you die, you end up dead, which is, you know, the primal fear of everything. Then ameliorated by the fact that it's going to happen no matter what. I think probably the worst way to die would be of very slow cancerous organ failure. Like where everything just fails piece after piece, and eventually you become just this big sort of lumpy parody of yourself where everything's about to fall off.
Wow.
But it's not happening fast enough.
Yeah,
that is very, very specific.
Yeah.
Very vivid. I like it. It's a good one. It is a good one. Yeah.
I've been doing this a while.
Yeah.
Okay, what was your very first pet?
My very first pet was a cat. No, I'm sorry. No, my very first pet was actually a gerbil. And
I love gerbils.
Like quick as hell.
You know, yeah, I never had a gerbil. I had hamsters and guinea pigs and ferrets, but never gerbils. They,
did you have rats?
I don't know.
I had rats. I had rats
yeah.
for quite a while. Yeah. I like rats.
The guinea pigs are cool to me because they just, they're just this big lump. Like, they don't do much. You know, they really, really, and they're furry, you know,
like,
and they're friendly.
I mean, they're smart, and they're, you know, it's like they've got all the nice things of being a rodent in that they're very responsive, and they're very soft and, you know, pleasant
yeah.
in that particular way. But they're also smart, and... Yeah, and they've got that wonderful nude tail, which is just so gross and odd.
It kind of is, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, who is your biggest influence, either in writing or just in life generally?
I would say in terms of writing, probably Caitlin Kernan has become my biggest influence. I'm fascinated by her ability with language. But also I'm fascinated by her work ethic, which is weird because she's constantly complaining about not writing very fast and, you know, and not being able to put stuff together and complaining about everything basically. But I am amazed by the way that she can get a job, get an idea and then just power through it. Other people who I also admire along that line would be people like Kathy Koja Kathy Koja, Peter Straub, King, Peter Straub, yeah, King, and the ever popular, oh my God, Joyce Carol Oates, who just seems to sneeze and a book comes out of her. You know, either at one end or the other. And it's like,
yeah,
I got this
I
idea
have to say,
like a second ago, and here it is. It's 500 pages long.
Yeah, I have to say, we're like halfway through these questions, and I have had no reason to be judgy. It's you know, and it never happens, you know. You normally get a from me occasionally, but no, nothing
yeah,
here
what's
yet.
What's that about?
Yeah, right.
Well, thank you. I guess
yeah.
I have good taste. Who knows?
You do. Okay, who or what, in your opinion, is the crappiest horror or supernatural being?
Oh, crappiest?
Like, yeah,
it's bad. Bad, boring. I'm not a huge fan of slashers in general. You know, just that sort of repetitious thing of, oh, there's a person who's gonna get killed, and they got killed, and here's another person who's gonna get killed, and again, strangely enough, you know, I. Particularly the type of slasher where you can never kill the motherfucker.
Oh,
know,
yeah,
like there's no
yeah.
way to ever kill them.
You know, what I think annoys me more than that is, you know, the victim, they're running. And, you know,
yeah.
like Jason is just sure. walking and he catches them. No. You
yeah,
know what
that
I mean?
Sort of goes, that sort of goes back to the mummy, though, you know. If you've ever seen any 1930s, 40s, 50s mummy
movies. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, where, you know, and I had a friend who used to say, Don Hutchison actually used to say, that that was because the mummy was a symbol of death, and no matter how fast you run, you can't outrun death. And I'm like, well, yeah, but at the same time.
Well, that's it. It would just shamble along, and then... You know, it would get, like you say, it would catch. Maybe as an allegory, yeah, that kind of works. But as a, you know, taking it literally, it was a bit of nonsense.
Well, yeah, you
really.
Know,
same with Frankenstein.
That way, it sort of becomes that EC Comics model of I'm
yeah.
coming to get you, Barbara, but I have to come very slowly because parts of me keep falling off. You know?
Okay, let's see. Oh, and this, I have to say, I do it all the time. This question. Frightens me a little bit when I'm talking to the horror authors. If it were legal to do so, would you eat human flesh?
You know, probably not.
Thank you.
Probably
Thank
not.
Thank you.
because of a couple of different things. And the first one is that humans are kind of like the pigeons of the world. So I just don't think that humans would taste all that great because we eat all sorts of crap all the time.
True. I like that answer.
Yeah. You know,
yeah.
It's sort of
that's
like
a really good answer.
Fed,
you know, we have the horror authors who will say, you know, they'll talk about barbecuing them and you know, a good recipe and stuff like that. And, you know, it's always funny. And then most of the people will, the ones that will say no, it'll be a squeamish reason. Like, ew, gross. But that was a really good answer. And I totally agree
yeah,
with you. So,
it's no interesting that Gemma has not picked on a moral issue. It's a practical issue that it might not taste nice. So that's telling. That is telling.
Yeah. Mm. Oh, I didn't even think about that. That's
that they taste okay, but let's face it. You know, Hannibal usually has to do a lot of stuff to that flesh to make it.
That is true.
Maybe yeah. it's just vegans. We'll just eat the vegans. You know, they might Okay.
Tibetan monks would be good because they'd be cleansed.
Wow.
Maybe.
Who is your favorite member of the British royal family?
Harry.
Yay! Love Harry.
Yeah, he
that was
fun.
So fast. Yeah.
Yeah. He's fun. To be frank, I find him sexy. You know, I was happy that he married Meghan Markle. So obviously he's not quite as committed to the usual colonialist bullshit that his family embodies.
Yeah.
You know? He's just like, no, I met this woman and she's beautiful and, you know, what the hell.
Yeah.
Yeah, hey, good on him.
Perhaps that she's very American in that particular way. What are you talking about, Mom?
Well, when you think about it, it wasn't, you know, relatively that long ago. Was it 1937 when the King of England abdicated because he wanted to marry an American divorcee?
Yep.
And Harry, okay,
right.
He's not king, probably unlikely to be king. But there was a day and age then that marriage would have been. I think Princess Margaret, she wanted to marry someone that wasn't deemed to be proper.
Yeah. And it was
stopped. But now it's like Harry wants to marry, you know, the girl from Suits, and yeah, good on you, boy. You know, and I like that.
Yeah,
you know, I like that he's just like buck the trend and, you know, bollocks with all. You know, he seems like a great guy.
Yeah. Yeah, I think he's trying to be as good as he can in the situation that he has to deal with.
Yeah.
You know, it's like he was born into a game preserve. And
yeah, very much, yeah.
The truth.
Okay, which franchise do you like the most? Halloween, Friday the 13th, Elm Street, Hellraiser, or Saw?
Okay, so I would say probably Hellraiser because Clive Barker.
Yay!
My guy. You know, back in high school, he was the dude that I read and I went, oh, you can do that? Oh, my God.
Yeah.
You can do anything. Perfect. Excellent.
And actually an answer I will accept, and I will not buzz you out just because Hellraiser is James's favorite. But, you know, you would have gotten better points had you said Halloween, just for future reference, because I'm sure we'll have
okay.
you back.
All right. Well, again, you know, I mean, the problem is that, you know, Michael's one of those guys. He's one of those unkillable motherfuckers.
Yes.
And I can't accept it. It's hard for me. You know,
well, see,
whereas
yeah, I like the Halloween remakes, like the Rob Zombies.
That are genuinely supernatural. You know, they're supernatural right? You know, and they're demons, and we have demons, and we have angels, and we have, you know, you know, S&M torture, and you know, lots and lots of weird sexual stuff behind everything. I like it.
What can I say?
Me too.
I'm like a Rob Zombie Halloween fan, and he wasn't, I mean, it's not like he was dead and buried or anything like that, so you can, you know, it could be left up to interpretation. Maybe he wasn't wounded as badly, you know, so it's,
I'm certainly looking forward to seeing the most recent Halloween sequel. And
yeah, with
Jamie
Lee Curtis,
but for Rob Zombie, I gotta say Devil's Rejects all the way.
Really, I think I'm only just a huge fan of the Halloweens. I think the other stuff, for me personally, I just watch kind of like I watch like a train wreck or something. I'm like, oh, dear Lord. You know?
Oh, it totally is. You know, it's like it's like he blended together every exploitation movie that he ever watched that he ever masturbated over when he was 13, you know? And and went like, oh, yeah, I'm going to put my wife in it. You know? But one way or the other, of the stuff that he's made, I still think he has great potential, and of the stuff that he's made, The Devil's Rejects has worked the best for me thus far. I'm looking forward to Three from Hell because I want to see what he does with it.
I just saw the preview for that. Yeah.
Oh, really? Why is that out now? Fantastic.
I think I'm scared. Yeah, I don't know.
I would agree with Gemma. Devil's Rejects was...
To actually kill them, send them to hell, and then have them break out of hell, you know, like in Drive Angry.
Okay, let's see. What is your least favorite part of the writing process?
Oh, the least favorite part. First draft is hard. It's really difficult. I tend to write long and then cut stringently. I have no problem cutting the shit out of my stuff. And what I say to my students all the time, because I do teach creative writing through Lit Reactor, usually twice a year, is you can fix bad writing, but you can't fix no writing. But man, sometimes that first draft, that you know what Doug Clegg calls the puke draft, where you're just like vomiting on the page, and you're like, oh God, this is awful. So bad. Oh,
yeah.
Get from here to there. What the fuck? Why can't I get there? I remember Caitlin Kernan talking about how she spent an entire day trying to get one of her characters to get up and cross the room and turn on a light switch. She couldn't figure out why they would do it. I'm not that bad. But yeah, there are these days where I'm just like, motherfucker, just do what I'm telling you to do. I mean, there's always an alchemical thing about writing, right? Where you know pretty much what needs to happen, but you don't know why it's going
to
happen.
How to get there. Yeah.
Go on.
I know that I have some writer friends that I talk to occasionally, and, they're always talking about, we had to cut this scene, and that is so... I am not good at that part. I mean, and it's not that I think everything can write in gold.
Other people really hate to edit, and I'm fine with it. I love to edit because editing makes things better.
I can't disagree. Okay. That was the last question. But we do have a bonus question, and this is basically for me here. Baseball or stamp collection?
God, are those the only two?
They are.
Stamp collection, I guess.
Oh, no!
Pretty much anything to do with sports, I'm not that interested.
Excellent. Oh, I like that. Well done. Good answer.
And you're in Toronto. I would love to come in and watch
a ball game with me. I don't think you would, actually. Because I'd be sitting there like the two dudes from the ID crowd going, he's kicked the ball. He's thrown it. Yes. Yeah. Now there's another ball thing going on.
That chap over there is running around a bit.
Yes, exactly.
Oh gosh, that's it, James. We're getting a guest that likes baseball, and we're going to talk about baseball because balls in baseball.
One day. Keep hope alive.
Wow.
But I am not that person, man. I am not that person. Sorry.
All right. Well,
no, I know the feeling.
Because she answered all the other questions so well, I will not judge her too harshly for that one. So, so I want to know what you're working on now.
Right now, I have three separate things that I'm working on. One of them is the final edit of Always After Three. Another one is for a Lovecraftian anthology, and it's basically about a horrible facial disease that only affects women. It's kind of a spin on The King in Yellow. The third one is another anthology solicit from a guy who I admire a lot. So, you know, that's its own kind of weirdness. You know, he's sort of like, I want something from you because I admire you so much. And I'm like, really? I admire you so much. Shit. You know, I guess I better come up with something really good.
Yeah. That's so awesome.
I'm not also working much slower than I should be on a on my next novel.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Again, it's a standalone horror novel, just like experimental film.
Awesome. Awesome. Sounds like you're pretty busy. And when you're not writing and you know working hard, who do you like to read?
Who do I like to read? The last couple of things I read were The Anomaly by Michael Rooker, The Cabin at the End of the World by Paul Tremblay. I'm really interested in narratives about cults, I love Paul anyway, so I knew that I would have to pick it up. And it is pretty amazing. Pretty awesome. I'm always reading something. I've always got a book in my bag. I've always got a book in the jar, and I'm always listening to something on Audible. On Audible I've been listening to F.G. Cottam, who's a British horror writer, and finishing off his Colony trilogy.
You know, I used to be that person who always had a book in my hands. It was always with me, no matter where I was. But
yep.
I haven't been. I can't remember the last time I finished a book. I edit. That's what I do. And by the time I'm done, at the day editing, I don't really want to pick up a book. I'm like, that's working now.
Absolutely. When I had to write about movies all the time, I didn't really see movies for fun, even vaguely, as much as I usually do, because it felt like work. I'm really happy that I'm not doing that anymore, so that I can watch movies, like, not quite 24/7, but like Billy-O, I can, do it whenever I want, and if I want to think about them, I can, but I don't have to.
So James, Gemma has agreed to share with us an embarrassing story, and I'm really excited because a lot of people, when I give them the choice, I've had people say, oh no, nothing ever embarrassing has happened to me.
Awesome. Oh well, let's do the intro and go for
Hi,
it.
I'm Patty, and I'm Thelma. What is your most embarrassing story?
All right. Okay, so when I was younger, I had trouble figuring out whether things were going on inside my head or outside my head. And in retrospect, this was probably because I was never officially diagnosed with Asperger's syndrome, but given that my son is autistic, it's, genetically, it's quite likely. Also given that, everything about my life up to a certain point. In retrospect, this was probably like a version of theory of mind. The general inability to understand the people around you also having interior lives, but crossbred with all the filtering I was doing to prevent myself from being overwhelmed by sensation. So ignoring what was going on around me semi-deliberately. So at one point I was singing by myself, my mom asked me where I'd learned green sleeves, and I was like, no, I made that up. And when she explained that I couldn't have, I was highly embarrassed. Similarly, one time I was in film class in high school, and the teacher, who was boring as hell, was droning on about this scene in Sergio Leone's Once Upon a Time in America, where there's this incredibly long traveling shot going around in a circle, and everyone, Robert De Niro, James Woods, Tuesday Weld, is just looking at each other and stirring their tea over and over without talking, looking at each other pretentiously or avoiding looking at each other, what have you. So I was sitting there reading, and when he stopped talking, I looked up and I went, oh, and you know what else is a really shitty scene? Has anyone seen Once Upon a Time in America? and I explained the entire thing over again because I genuinely, deliberately hadn't been listening to him and yet had obviously somehow absorbed every detail. And when I got to the end, the teacher looked at me and said, "Get the fuck out of here, Gemma, and don't come back." And everyone...
Whoa.
Nice.
Yep. That's my embarrassing story.
It's so funny. For some reason, it reminded me. You know how, well, and then I say this part, and I've had people say, "No, I don't know what, you know, what that's like." But you ever go to the doctor, and you, that one question, you know, do you ever hear or see things that aren't there? And I'm always, okay, has anybody else asked this question? I cannot be the only one. Seriously, really? Somebody say something. But I'm thinking...
The last time somebody asked me that question, I was taking a test to be a security guard. To be vetted as a security guard. So, of course, I answered no.
Yeah, I'm thinking, how would you know? Like, if you were seeing something or hearing something that really wasn't there, you're still seeing it and hearing it. So, how would you know? Yeah,
yeah,
so, I mean...
have no idea.
Thank you. I think the same thing. So
I mean, obviously there are some things that are more logically likely to be there than others, you know. So if you see a guy and the top of his head opens up and birds fly out of his brain, then you know.
Then you have to wonder what drugs you took.
The likelihood of that being functionally true is lower than other things. But yeah, otherwise it's like, no, you know, it's, we only perceive the world through our own perceptions. And so, yeah.
it totally, that kind of stuff just totally wigs me out. I've known people who have, you know, had like schizophrenia or something and just what the mind can make you think, and it's terrifying. It really is. It's too scary. I would love to read a horror. If anybody could suggest or recommend a horror book that deals with this, like totally just batshit crazy. I think that would be kind of cool to read. It'd probably freak me out, but I would really like to read it.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot to be said for the unreliable narrator. The one time that I dislike that trope intensely is when you get about halfway through a book and you're just like, oh, wait a minute. You flip to the end and you're like, oh, yeah, she was crazy the entire time. So really, none of that happened. And if it did, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Because you'll never know.
Yeah, it kind of spoils it a bit.
Yeah, exactly. No, it's like, wow, you wasted my time. Thank you.
So do you ever read or write anything that isn't horror?
I read nonfiction when I'm researching something. One of my favorite books is a book about parasitism called Parasite Rex. Things living inside of other things living on other things.
Yikes.
Yikes indeed. It has this wonderful picture on the front of a cross-section of a fish's head, and an isopod has swum into the fish's mouth and chewed up the fish's tongue, and is now pretending to be the fish's tongue. So,
yeah,
you know,
eats the tongue, yeah.
Exactly.
Gemma and I, we need to spend some time together. We could talk about stamps. I did a degree in zoology, and parasitology was one of my majors, and absolutely love all of it. My favorite is the Toxocara that gets into rats and mice, and it makes them sexually attracted to cats, which is fantastic, because obviously the parasite's objective is to get eaten.
Yeah. And then crapped out in the.
I know. I mean, that is just evolution at its finest. I love that.
Yes, exactly.
I love that.
I like science. I like biology. History. Love history. Very, very interested in history, particularly archaeology. I'm a big fan of archaeology.
Oh wow!
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
That's really cool.
Yeah,
we definitely need to have you back on, but, you know, you and James could definitely talk about, you know, your hatred of baseball, but I think we should have another guest that is
I've often said I could get my stamp collection out on the air, and we could have a whole show just going through my British commemorative stamps collection. So that would be a great show. That would.
Well, I can get together some baseball stats, and that would be fun. That would be a great show, baseball and stamp collecting. We should definitely do that. Yeah.
As long as we can occasionally have side roads into talking about horror, I'm there.
Yeah.
I think a whole show of baseball would be pretty horrific for me. Anyway.
You're doing that demon thing. It's that time of night, I believe. And, you know, occasionally James does this robot demon voice, and it's usually at the very end of the show. And so I think that, are you there, Dan? Yeah. And I think we're time to say goodbye. I think we have, like, our little song there. And so I want to thank you so much for coming on the show, Gemma, and tell us where we can find you online.
Okay, probably the best place, creepily enough, is either Twitter or Facebook. I'm at Gemma Files on Twitter, and I'm Gemma Files on Facebook.
Okay.
Those are the two best places.
Normally, I would have already had the guest the information put up and stuff on our website and our Facebook page, but, you know, it was like, you know, I haven't done that yet because it was like last minute, so I will get that done. Anybody who wants to stalk Gemma can go to our page and, you know, stalk her from there. And again, you have to promise to come back and see us.
I will totally do that.
Yay!
This has been wonderful. Okay. Thank you so much.
No, thank you for coming on the show.
Okay. All right.
Yes, and I think this is usually around the time that James tells me it's time to say goodnight, Xtina. So goodnight, Xtina!